internationally renowned financial and banking center, Manamah, Bahrain, is to host the 24th World Islamic Banking Conference in December 2017. Running for almost a quarter of a century, the event has reinforced its status as not only the longest-running Islamic banking conference in the world, but also to serve as a compass for the global Islamic finance and banking industry. Attracting financiers, policymakers, ethical finance advocates, and thought leaders from over 50 countries, the event looks to progress and evolve the global Islamic banking and finance industry.
So this is Mohammed Chowdhury on behalf of Islam Channel at the World Islamic Banking Conference in Manamah, Bahrain. This conference has been going on for 24 years consecutively, and it is the largest Islamic banking conference and attracts approximately 1,000 people from more than 50 countries. I'm pleased to be sitting with our brother Tanvir Ijaz, who is a director of Middle East
Global Advisors,
yeah. MAGA, who organized this conference.
To give you a little bit of background of Middle East Global Advisors, we're a financial consultancy and event management company. We've been around for the past 24 years. MAGA started in 1992. And during the time, Islamic finance industry was in infancy. Since then, has been 24 years. And all this while, we have been very focused on the Islamic finance industry. And you can see the culmination of that struggle. Next year, we're celebrating the 25th ceremony of the World Islamic Banking Conference, our flagship conference. And we're very proud of the role that we have played in furthering Islamic finance industry and promoting it not just in the region but around the world. As you earlier mentioned, that the conference is attended by people coming from more than 50 countries, and that is something we're really proud of. If you take the example of this year's conference, so we had people from Australia, from Germany, from UK, from South Africa, and Malaysia, from all around the world.
The World Islamic Banking Conference attracts many sponsors, none bigger than Al Baraka Banking Group, advocates of and one of the leaders in the world of Islamic banking.
Not only this year, but over a number of years that you've been supporting this conference. You're an industry leader, you've been in this business for a long time. When did you start in the Islamic banking industry? Can you just give us some background?
I started as a banker since 1973. And I grew up in the banking sector, taking from a very junior position to the senior position. And I spent 20 years in ABC, as you said, and it was a very good years of experience. And then I moved and I created Al Baraka Banking Group, which combined all Al Baraka subsidiaries under one umbrella, which is called Al Baraka Banking Group. And now we are operating in 15 countries, and total balance sheet is about $26 billion, with over 700 branches and 13,000 staff. We are the biggest Islamic, as well as an Arab bank, traditional banks, in this part of the world. Because 700 or over 700 branches, I don't think that there is Arab banks or Islamic banks, they have these numbers of branches outside their countries.
Al Baraka is one of the longest standing Islamic banks. It became a pioneer in laying the foundations for the Islamic financial landscape to grow and flourish into what we have today, both in the Middle East and further afield.
Al Baraka is one of the oldest Islamic banking groups.
Yes.
Can you just give us a little bit of background, who set it up, why it was set up?
You know that the Islamic banking was supported by a pioneer in Islamic banks, which was at that time, there were about four people. In Kuwait, we have Kuwait Finance House.
Yes.
And in Saudi Arabia, we have two. Rahmatullah Ali Muhammad Al-Faisal, Prince Muhammad Al-Faisal Amir, wa Sheikh Saleh Kamil. And in the Emirate or in Dubai, we have Saeed Luta, Sheikh Saeed Luta. For these four people, they spend a lot of time and money to promote the Islamic banking because it was a very complicated things because central banks in this part of the world, they don't understand very well what does it mean Islamic banking and what is the product to be approved by this institution. So it took them a while to explain this to everybody. Yeah. Now I think that it reached to the maturity whereby now banks in Europe as well as in the Far East, they accept the Islamic products.
Islamic finance, having previously been on the fringes of the industry, is slowly making its mark in and has come to the attention of the wider financial market in recent years, in particular for its religious foundations and fundamental principles, which align strongly with ethical finance.
So maybe I'll start with a provocative question. Why do we need Islamic banking? Why can't we just do with normal conventional banks?
There are many Muslims in the world that take religion very seriously. There are lots who don't, but there are a lot also who do. And those who do would want this option to be available to them to practice their religion as much as they can. Now, having said this, this doesn't mean that this excludes non-Muslims from dealing with Islamic banks.
Obviously, Islamic banking principles is not only focused on interest, but also like ethical investing. So for example, we don't finance tobacco or alcohol or businesses, etc. So there are other values that other people who are not necessarily Muslims can share.
Yes. This is also sometimes debated. Why do we call ourselves ethical investing or ethical banking? The sound of it is that the rest is not. But I think there are in the world lots of funds, they call themselves conventional, but they call themselves ethical funds. What they mean by that is that they refrain from investing in certain activities that are not viewed positively by at least some segments in different societies, whether those societies are in the West or in the East. For example, investing in casinos. Is considered by some as an unethical and by others maybe ethical. But from a religious point of view and from a conservative point of view, those sorts of investments in pornography, for example, and weaponry and so on sometimes are not viewed favorably. And if you restrain yourself from investing on those, then you could be labeled as an ethical investment company or ethical investor if you seek those.
Although a growing area of finance, Islamic finance is still a niche when compared to the 200-year-old conventional financial system, so has to overcome more challenges and barriers in its advancement.
The infrastructure for the conventional banking industry is there in every country, and people understand it. The Islamic banking industry's infrastructure is not there in every country. And so it is not para passu.
Like in terms Bahrain or Malaysia, you get a lot of support. In other countries, you get less support.
You get less support. IOFI standards with respect to accounting and auditing and the other Sharia
it's not
standards.
Adapted in every country.
Not
like
adapted
Bahrain.
In every country. Bahrain is adapting them. Lots of other countries are. But not every country adapts these standards. Not every country has got a special unit in their central bank to deal with Islamic banks and regulate them and monitor them and have good oversight over them. So without those structures, we cannot operate.
Well, the positive side is that continuously growth for the Islamic banking globally. It's a very much high demand for Islamic banks. On the other side, the challenges that we have is that we need to work on reaching out to potential investors and clientele globally.
The subprime mortgage collapse of 2007, which developed into a full-blown international banking crisis in 2008, impacted globally and served to highlight the chase for profit and money-making at any cost in the banking sector, not to mention the widespread failures in financial regulation and corporate governance and lack of transparency, among other issues.
What distinguishes financial services, and in particular banks, from other sectors, is that they are the custodian or the guardian of the nation's wealth. That's the only main factor differentiating the financial sector. But this factor should not, you know, give this industry, i.e. the banking industry, the right to basically, you know, get more remuneration. They should be adequately remunerated to provide the right service, but not excessively remunerated.
Despite being a considerably smaller market than conventional finance, the sector of Islamic finance, a growing niche, is not immune from trials and tribulations, having suffered from compliance issues too.
In terms of compliance, we've seen failures. We've seen hefty fines, you know, by main regulators on the banks. Why? Again, it is linked to the incentives.
Okay.
It's linked to remuneration,
okay.
Right? But compliance, you know, strict compliance leads to stability, long-term stability. Weak compliance leads to short life.
Okay.
What I meant is, you know, sticking to the laws and regulation.
Okay.
You have to fully comply with the laws and regulation.
Keep aside investment Islamic banks, because investment has its own risk. You can sometimes succeed, and some other times you may not, depending on market conditions and so on and so forth. But commercial banking is a different league. Commercial Islamic banks have never failed throughout their history, including during the financial crisis. And that's mainly because of their structure and model.
And the governance.
And the way they conduct business, yeah. And the different governance levels that we have embedded in Islamic banking.
The overarching principle of Islamic finance is that all forms of interests are forbidden. The mechanism by which Islamic finance operates is based on mutuality, fairness, and risk sharing.
The way it works is that depositors' money is put alongside shareholders' money, and any profits made is after deducting expenses is distributed proportionately.
Okay.
In good times, Islamic bankers, depositors earn far greater than their conventional counterparts.
Instead of getting 1% interest rate,
you probably get 6 or 7. Okay. I remember pre-financial crisis, Kuwait Finance House used to distribute 8% to their depositors, while the conventional counterparts used to distribute 2 or 2.5, okay, or less, because we share in the profit. So an Islamic banking depositor shares more of the profit with the shareholders. So the shareholders, in conclusion, takes less than a conventional shareholder because it is shared with the depositors. Now, in return, when there are crises, the Islamic bankers' depositor will share some of the loss,
okay,
with the shareholder.
So that's the flip side of enjoying the good times.
Yes, but that comes
Very rarely,
yeah. It hasn't come so far with the commercial, yeah, Islamic banks. Since the establishment of commercial Islamic banks, this has not happened.
There is a strong argument which suggests that had conventional banks and financial institutions had the structure of Islamic finance, the 2008 financial crisis could have been averted. Many within the sector assert that the main tenets of Islamic finance create a more transparent banking structure.
This is a very important differentiation between an Islamic bank and a conventional bank. I would assert further that had Citibank or Deutsche Bank were Islamic banks during the financial crisis,
they would have fared better.
Governments wouldn't have had to put money into them and bail them out, because what it would have been to take 100 billion out of a 2 trillion billion bank. It would be very small amount that everybody would have shared in it. The majority of the bank's capital would have been intact.
Okay.
depositors would not have felt that during a huge financial crisis, small amount, the bank would have continued business.
So the argument you're making is the vast majority of the assets in Citibank and Deutsche were financed by depositors, so spreading the loss amongst those depositors would have been much less costly than governments stepping
probably
in.
Probably unnoticeable, because depositors during the financial crisis were threatened much greater to the what would have been the proportion of their loss to carry had the bank been Islamic.
One controversial but unavoidable aspect of banking for Islamic finance institutions is to benchmark the fees they charge against the global index of LIBOR in order to remain competitive in the market. The London Interbank Offered Rate serves as the first step to calculating interest rates on various loans throughout the world.
Benchmark is like an index people use to price certain things. Now, of course, if we have an index which is not based on interest rate, it is more preferred by us. But since we are a very tiny market in a big, huge market, and our prices must be comparable with others, we cannot use a different benchmark at the time being.
At the outset, we should say, of course, this is not the ideal way. If we could do it, if the banks could do it in any other way, avoiding anything that has to do with interest, of course, that would be preferable. We have to recognize that banks are operating in a system that only tolerates Islamic banking principles up to an extent. Everywhere in the world, even in Muslim countries, central banks, all banks are subject to regulation and oversight by central banks. Central banks, in essence, and actually are conventional banks. So they are, in a way, they are the bank of banks, right? Its clients are banks.
Yes.
But they supervise and manage the funds of these different banks.
But if somebody can develop a benchmark which is globally accepted by everybody, or even locally accepted by all the banks, then we welcome it. Yeah. And I have many times said that this researcher will be very famous and very rich maybe also. But as we stand today, it's very difficult. Although LIBOR and others, they were subject of criticism, as you know, manipulated and these things, and they were also punished by the regulators. So, but until now, people have not come up with a benchmark which can be used globally.
Being at the forefront of implementing Islamic finance regulations and housing some of the chief standard-setting institutions in the global Sharia-compliant area, Bahrain is at the vanguard of the global Islamic financial services industry in the region.
Bahrain has, managed to, do the extra mile in Islamic finance. Because there was a political will to support and welcome Islamic finance. And there was a technical support as well as financial support extended by the Central Bank of Bahrain. And at the time when, worldwide, there were only one country supporting Islamic finance, and that was Bahrain. And based on that, Bahrain was selected to be the base for the auditing and accounting organization for Islamic financial institutions, known as IOFI. Bahrain consider Islamic finance as one of the main sector that promises more growth and that will attract more investments going forward.
Financial technology, or fintech as it is more commonly known, has become a buzzword in recent years. Innovations in this sector of finance are rapidly changing the way we do banking and finance.
In the past 3 years, we have completely changed the whole format of the conference. We have introduced a few new things. As you mentioned, our focus on technology, because the disruption caused by technology is actually now reaching the region, and to make sure that the decision makers are fully equipped with the insights, we have started covering fintech in great detail, crowdfunding, cryptocurrencies, and blockchain.
Fintech is slowly democratizing the financial landscape, allowing people from all regions of the world, especially those in developing nations who don't have access to traditional banks, to be able to carry out financial transactions, such as banking and money transfers online via accessible technology, mobile phones.
In the Middle East and in the Muslim countries, there are lots of areas and great number of populations that have not yet dealt with banks, don't have bank accounts, don't have access to the financial services. And with the advent and the huge leaps in the world of technology, we hope and we look for the day when everybody can deal with these financial institutions that have bank accounts, so they become accessible to us as well, offering our services to them. And as we know, when you do something positive in the telecommunication world or bringing services to areas that are far away and in remote areas, you can really have or create a domino effect, helping everybody doing more things, develop themselves economically, improve their lives, get better education, and so on and so forth, and definitely would want banking services.
Next time on Disrupting Islamic Finance, the role of the Central Bank of Bahrain will be explored in facilitating the growth of fintech in the Islamic finance space.
There is a special focus on Islamic banking by the Central Bank of Bahrain. This central bank is the first to issue a regulatory sandbox on fintech.
I think the trends that everybody is talking about is, of course, thanks to CBB approval to have sandbox, and they basically give us a chance to test fintech products, and so we can have access to the world with our products.
Also, the impact of the digital revolution in the finance sector in the Middle East will be further examined.
We are changing the very way we look at digitization. We'd like to be known as a technology company eventually that happens to offer financial services. The space we are quickly and feverishly working in is offering everything digital to the millennials and even to old people like me.
Wahed is the world's first halal robo advisor. A robo advisor is basically an automated investment platform.